We are live with Now You See TV. This is Jon Pounders, and like every Saturday night, we have David Carrico with us, and tonight we have a special show. Hopefully, we're seeing where Zin's at. Zin's supposed to be here. He's not here yet, so we're starting the show off. We're going to be talking about the Gates of Enoch, and if any of you have ever read the Book of Enoch, one of the most interesting books you can read when it comes to the Nephilim, and it kind of just elaborates.
He's not here yet,
so we're starting the show off. We're going to be talking about the Gates of Enoch.
Sorry,
if any of you have ever got the YouTube video playing in the background, my bad. But in the Book of Enoch, it talks about these gates. It talks about the sun's path. It talks about the luminaries' paths. And up till recently, this has been a mystery because it doesn't quite make sense if you look at the world through a global eye. If you look at the world through a geocentric heliocentric, or if you look at the world through the eyes of modern science, it doesn't make sense. So we are going to talk a little bit about that and get into it tonight with Zin Garcia and David Carrico. If Zin shows up, if he doesn't, me and David are going to ramble on about something and have a good time with that. So we'll see what happens. We're going to give him about 5 to 10 minutes. Most people love the Book of Enoch. We can go on about that forever. But I just want to say thank you all for listening so thus far. If for those of you that are listening on YouTube, I'm going to try to be keeping track of YouTube and the regular chat tonight. If possible, if Zin shows up. If not, we will not be regulating the YouTube chat once again. You can join our live chat, join our moderated chat over on our website. And if you look at the video you're watching down below it, in the description, there's a link that takes you right over to our website where you can hang out in our chat, fellowship with like-minded people, and ask questions to the guest or myself through this chat. And we usually get to them in the last 30 to 45 minutes toward the end. We try to get through almost all of them. Sometimes we don't have time. We usually go through 20 to 30 questions. So make sure you guys get over there, get your questions in. And it looks like we have the Zin Master, Zin Garcia. I shouldn't call him the Zin Master. That's probably not what he would like to be called. But anyways, David, how's it going, man?
It is going fantastic. I am really excited about the show tonight. It is going to be a hootie bob, and I'm really looking forward to it.
Yep, and John's not with us tonight. He's been on two 24-hour shifts prior to this. His wife did a really good job filling in for him last night with Virtual House Church. We had a lot of listeners on Virtual House Church overall, more than ever before, and I think a lot of it had to do with Patricia being on there. Maybe you guys like her more than like us, or it could be too. We had a Facebook Live going while we were doing the show, so we had it on Facebook and we had it on there, so people seemed to be filtering over. So really, really good audience last night, and we're just thankful. Welcome to the show, Zin. I'm going to let you and David talk, and I'm going to be moderating the chat rooms while you guys talk. But it's good to have you back, Zin. It's been a while since you've been on, and I apologize for not having you on sooner. I've been moving, and it's been crazy in my neck of the woods. It's been a nonstop wrestling fit, basically, to get all the stuff here, get everything moved in, and get the other house ready to sell. It's been completely ridiculous. So I've everything's been crazy, but I'm glad to have you back on here, brother.
It's my honor, my pleasure to be here with both of you. And I know how, you know, difficult it is to transition and move. And the fact that you even had any chance at all to do shows while, you know, going through all of that is, kudos to you being able to juggle all that. I appreciate the opportunity, and always considered a privilege and an honor to be here in fellowship with both of you and the listening audience. I do consider everybody that comes to listen to the shows very wise and well-versed in their own seeking. And so it's awesome to be able to fellowship with others that have also done and dedicated themselves to the kind of research that we ourselves do.
Amen. And while you're talking, you don't have anything up. I'm going to put this picture up here for you when you're talking, since you don't have a picture on there. But if you want to screen share anything, let me know, and I will take this down.
Oh, no, that's perfect. That's I like that image. You do really well with those images, too, brother. I'm well impressed with all of your work.
I appreciate that, man. My son helped me color Copernicus here. It was a statue, gray statue, and we colored him up, and he wanted to give him green eyes and white hair and all that stuff. So I was like, okay, let's do it. Let's color him up.
Ought to put like horns on his head and stuff.
I gave him some black eyeliner and stuff too, so he looks pretty creeped out. So.
Is this again Copernicus?
That's awesome.
I don't know. Yeah.
You know, it's book cover quality, really.
It is very good. Very good.
Thanks, man. I've done like 200 or 300 of them, so hopefully by now I've gotten a little better at it. I was looking back at some of the first ones I did, and I'm like, that was pretty wrong there, but oh well. So.
Well, I apologize for coming in a little bit late. I thought we were on from midnight till 2, but it's actually better for me that we're on a little bit earlier.
Right. Nope. That'd be a little too much starting at midnight. I mean, that'd be even a little too much for us, you know.
Yeah. Yeah, well, no problem. Well, it's good to be here. And so,
well, thank you, Ben. I'll introduce our topic tonight.
Excellent.
Our topic tonight is the Gates of Enoch. And this is going to be dealing with the Book of Enoch, and specifically with the Book of the Heavenly Luminaries. And it's based upon a teaching that I did on FOJC Radio Church. And if you would like to hear the original Opening the Gates of Enoch teaching, it's on our YouTube channel. You can go to fojcradio.com and hit the link to our YouTube channel, and you can see the original teaching. And I'm sure there's things in it we won't talk about tonight, and there's things we'll talk about tonight that aren't in it. And it's based on we're going to talk about the significance of the 12 gates in the Book of Enoch. And it's got a profound impact upon our spiritual life and upon Bible prophecy and upon things that happened in olden time. And I would never have seen this if it would not been for Zinn's book on the flat earth as the key to decrypt the Book of Enoch. And I was just so glad when Zinn agreed to come on and talk about these concepts. And we're going to be really pushing the envelope tonight, as always. So we want you to be prepared, not only to be intellectually challenged, but also spiritually challenged, as we are going to look at this very compelling topic. And as Zen so well pointed out, and as I am just so firmly agree with him, that the Book of Heavenly Luminaries, which I believe it's chapters 71 to 82 in the Book of Enoch, that it makes no sense unless you look at it from a flat earth biblical cosmology. Those chapters make no sense whatsoever if you try to understand them with the heliocentric global cosmology. But I'm going to let our dear brother Zen, and I'm so glad that he is joining me tonight, and we are just really going to let all the horses out tonight and see where this takes us. But Zen, set this up for us and lay the foundation for the Gates of Enoch.
Sure. I guess I should start with just a background story on what led me to this as revelation. And like most of us, I was very hesitant to even begin an investigation on the flat earth as topic or biblical concept, and avoided it for a very long time, until some of my listeners and some of my closest friends kept pressing me on it and said that I should be open-minded, that I asked my own listeners to enter into the topics of the books that I write and the radio shows that I do with similar open-mindedness. And so I agreed to spend some time looking into it. And when I did so, I immediately recognized that, first, the Bible affirms that the earth does not move, and the scientific experiments, Saganac, Aries failure, the Michelson-Morley Gale, and other repeatable scientific experiments, parallax, Bedford level, as far as checking the curvature, finding that their curvature is non-existent and undetectable and non-measurable. Well, those two things made me revisit the scriptures and examining such topics as Joshua, the sun and the moon. Joshua being given the authority to stop the sun and the moon, and also the sun going back 10 degrees on the sundial, how any of that could make any sense when applying it to the heliocentric worldview as we've been taught, it just piqued my interest even further. And so I then began to investigate this as topic most of my day and for several months and several years now. But there was a portion, and most of you know that are familiar with my work, that I study a lot of the extra-biblical texts. And there's a portion of the Book of Enoch which I was never able to make sense of, and that was the book on the courses of the heavenly luminaries. And being open to this new possibility and embracing it as concept for where we are as far as the world, the circle of the earth, and the enclosed world system, I decided to revisit that portion of the text to see if I could then make sense of it. And as I did so, in reading the material and coming to the description of the movement of the sun and the moon, because it describes this motion twice in the Book of Enoch. Enoch describes its movement as being from east to west and then north to east. And trying to make sense of that movement, applying that to the heliocentric worldview and to the earth being spinning like a top as it orbits annually around the sun, one can't make any kind of decrypt that motion or understand it in any kind of way. But then when I applied it to the flat earth, the like it, as described in Isaiah 40, verse 22, when you take the circle of the earth and you have the heavens spread out above it as a tabernacle, and if you are looking down upon that tabernacle from above, then you apply the motions of the sun moving from east to west, north, and then back to the east. Well, Enoch is basically describing the motion as a circle. And so when I understood that, then I began to read all of the chapters and all of the verses associated with the movements of the sun, moon, and stars and all of the heavenly luminaries, and applying it to a depiction of the earth as laid out, as we see displayed in the United Nations map of the azimuthal equidistant map, the projection map, as you're looking down upon it, where all of the continents of the earth move or gathered in circle around the North Pole as center of the earth plane. And I could completely see how Enoch had to have been taken probably to where Polaris is, because that, as I have since learned, is also where the throne of the Most High God in the heavenly temple is located, and that anytime the various prophets and apostles are taken to the throne room of God or before his throne or to the heavenly temple, this is the location that they are taken to. And so when I understood that, I knew that Enoch was given an explanation of the movements of all of the luminaries as he was looking down upon the circle of the earth from above, from the position of the center of the vaulted dome, which is where Polaris is located. And this is why Polaris, as star, is the only fixed star in the celestial night, and it's the one that does not move, because it represents the center of the vaulted dome. And as I said, that is also where the Most High is, as it says in Isaiah, seated on the circle of the earth, has his throne fixed above the vaulted dome of the earth. And so then applying all of that, I was able to decrypt the entire book on the courses of the heavenly luminaries and the motions that Enoch was ascribing to the sun, the moon, and all the stars, and the movement of the zodiac, the sun moving, as Enoch says, above the earth and in the face of the sky. And then that's when I decided to write my ninth book, The Flat Earth, as key to decrypt the book of Enoch, because that's exactly what it was. It was only by applying my newly discovered understanding that we live upon the circle of the earth, as August Picard described in his 1931, in the testimony he gave in the Popular Mechanics, that August 1931 issue of the Popular Mechanics, he described the earth as a circle with an upturned edge. And when you understand that, this is exactly what is described in many scriptures. For instance, in this passage here, it describes all the rivers and springs of water continually flow into the water of the ocean, which surrounds the world like a ring. But the ocean is not filled in the places where the rivers continually flow. They return there in order to flow from the spouts of the deep. So that ring is the Antarctic Circle, where it says in many references that this is the boundaries which the Most High established and said to the proud waves to be stayed, and here you go no further. And so
that's in
the passage that I just read from is actually it's a the Targum version of Ecclesiastes 1, chapter 1, verses 3 through 7, which is where I want to start in order to establish the premise for the motions of the sun as it moves through the six gates of heaven. Because this is it's a confirming witness to what Enoch describes in the chapters, the many chapters on the Book of the Courses of the Heavenly Luminaries. Solomon in Ecclesiastes chapter 1 gives a short, very concise, detailed description of this same motion and movement, but it's only when you read the Targum version that you get this understanding. And so I'll open with what it says in the King James and then explain what Solomon is actually referencing. And this will help everybody to picture and to understand what we're going to go into as far as the gates of heaven from the book of Enoch. And so it says this in the King James Version. The sun also ariseth, this is beginning with verse 5, the sun also ariseth, and the sun goeth down, and hasteth to his place where he arose. The wind goeth toward the south, and turneth about unto the north. It whirleth about continually, and the wind returneth again according to his circuits. All the rivers run into the sea, yet the sea is not full. Unto the place from whence the rivers come, thither they return again. That's the King James Version. Now, the Targum Version elaborates a little bit more in detail as to the motions of the sun, which are described. Whereas in verse 6 in the King James Version, the motion, the southward and northward motion, is attributed to the wind. In the Targum Version, it's a continuation of the sun's motion. And what Solomon is actually describing is, just as I decrypted in my Flat Earth as Key to Decrypt the Book of Enoch, Enoch describes the sun's movement through the six gates of heaven as being a northward and southward motion from the Tropic of Capricorn to the Tropic of Cancer and back again, and that these six gates divide in breadth that particular area, which also in 1 year, the sun will begin on the vernal equinox on the equator, move towards the Tropic of Cancer, and upon reaching the Tropic of Cancer, will reverse course and begin moving southward. And when it reaches the equator again, that is the autumnal equinox, it will continue until reaching the Tropic of Capricorn, and then it will reverse course. And so this is the northward-southward movement that is being described in Ecclesiastes, which again, once you understand that, it's the sun that is being described in verse 6 and not just the wind, that it helps you to understand that this is also what Enoch is describing. And so I'll read the Targum version of this particular chapter. It says this: "The sun rises by day from the east side, and the sun sets on the west side at night, and it glides into its place going by the path of the deep. And it rises the next day from the place where it rose there yesterday." In verse 6 it says, "It goes along the whole south side by day and returns to the north side by the path of the deep. Round and round it goes to the wind of the northern side at the period of Nisan and Tammuz," which this description is very important because it's in Nisan that the sun is found on the vernal equinox, beginning the season of spring, which if you understand God's calendar, as I describe also in this book, God's calendar is linear. It begins with spring, moves into summer, fall, and ends with winter. Unlike the Gregorian solar pagan calendar, which begins in January in the middle of winter and then ends in December in the, you know, also in the middle of winter. And so God's calendar is linear, which makes sense when, you know, you consider the movement of the sun. And so he says, "To the wind of the northern side at the period of Nisan and Tammuz." Tammuz is when it reaches the Tropic of Cancer and then reverses course, which is the vernal equinox and the summer solstice, as I explained. "And on its circuit, it returns to the wind of the southern side." So when it reaches the Tropic of Cancer, Solomon describes here, it reverses course and begins moving south at the period of Tishri and Tibet, which Tishri is when it reaches the equator for the autumnal equinox, and Tibet is when it reaches the Tropic of Cancer for the winter solstice. Continuing, "It goes out from the eastern lattices at dawn and enters through the western lattices in the evening. All the rivers and springs of water continually flow into the water of the ocean, which surrounds the world like a ring. But the ocean is not filled, and to the place is where the rivers continually flow. They return there in order to flow from the spouts of the deep." And so Solomon also describes in this this passage at the very end how the oceans of the world surround all the continents and how they're contained in a ring, in a circle, which is exactly what is described in the Book of Enoch and also in other portions. Like, I will share a passage from First Clement here in just a few minutes, which also describe this motion, this movement, and also the earth as, again, this flat circular plane with upturned edges, as August Picard describes. And but let me give you a chance to comment.
Help me to picture this is the understanding that Enoch was caught up into the heavenlies, and Uriel was showing this to him from a heavenly vantage point, as if he was looking down upon it. And then it starts to make sense.
Yes, exactly. Which is very important. It's the only way that you can make sense of the fullness of the Book of Enoch as it is described in the book on the courses of the heavenly luminaries, is by applying the motions and the descriptions of those motions to, you know, as we're saying, Enoch being caught up, taken towards the very throne room of the Most High God, which sits directly above Polaris. And then looking down is given description of all of these motions and these movements by the angel Uriel. And so it's, you know, it's in his descriptions of those motions and in writing it into the Book of Enoch that we have all of this cosmology and all of this understanding encoded for what has been thousands of years. And it's only been, you know, in since I wrote this book, because for the last 500 years and the embrace of heliocentrism as the explanation for where we are and who we are as far as the earth and being humans inhabiting the earth, this knowledge has been lost. And nobody has been able to make heads or tails of the descriptions in the book on the courses of the heavenly luminaries because all of us have been trying to apply that to our understanding of the earth as a globe.
And back in ancient times, in Bible days, we might say, everybody understood this. And I made a little joke that my next book was going to be the Flat Earth as the key to decrypt the Egyptian Book of the Dead. Because when I understood the correct biblical cosmology, the Egyptian Book of the Dead makes sense just like the Book of Enoch did. Because in the Egyptian Book of the Dead, the Pharaoh wants to ascend to the waters above the firmament. And yeah, I got that immediately when I understood the biblical concept. And also, we could say that the flat earth cosmology is the key to decrypt the whole Word of God.
Yes.
Because you have to either accept what the Word of God says, or you have to take every scripture in the Word of God that applies the cosmology and say, well, it's just symbolic. You have to absolutely throw them all out because every one of them flatly contradicts, as you've so well said, this heliocentric globular cosmology. And you know, in my mind, I've had to come to the place where I'm gonna believe the Word of God, and I know that's where so many of our listeners are. And if you're not at that place, I can understand that, because this has just been something that I've only begun to look at since May, and it is really a paradigm buster, especially for well, for everybody that has been taught everything to the contrary. But if you begin to study it, you're going to run it. You'll run it for yourself. But well, one more thing in Ecclesiastes 1:6, I can understand here the correlation between the Targum and the King James when it says the wind goeth toward the south. The Hebrew word ruah can mean wind or spirit. And in the Book of Enoch, it also teaches us that the angels actually move the heavenly luminaries. So I can get that connection and the jump there between the King James and the Targum.
Well, here's the other important thing to understand about the correlation between the sun and the moon. And this is also described in the Book of Enoch when he describes the heavenly gates of heaven also connected to the winds. The winds follow the sun. Like, if you understand how the sun moves back and forth between the Tropic of Cancer and the Tropic of Capricorn, as the sun is moving back and forth, the winds also follow. So, for instance, when the sun moves from the equator, reaches the Tropic of Cancer, that is the shortest day of the year. It is moving in a very short and tight revolution. And then as it begins to move southward again, and the winds will follow, which is why when it reaches the equator and begins to start moving into the southern latitudes, which I call the Hemis Plain, the southern Hemis Plain, the winds, the polar winds, also move southward. And the Arctic winds actually reach into the southern latitudes. And so the wind actually does follow the movement of the sun. And the temperature, the heat that the sun creates by playing off of both the land masses and also off of the oceans and the seas and the rivers, that's also what creates the precipitation and the movements of the rain and the storms across the, you know, like for the United States, they move down and follow the mountain chain, the Grand Canyon, which isn't confined just to Colorado and Arizona, but actually begins in Alaska and moves all the way down to the very southern tip of South America. And so the winds and the storms also follow the movement of this mountain chain, as in, and then it also spreads out across the United States as the winds are pushed in that direction. And so the winds also follow the movement of the sun. And so that's why I believe that it is correlated, but it is important to understand that the verse 6 is also connected to the sun and not just the winds. But I have another confirming witness that I'd like to share. And this is something that I recently discovered. It's not even published in my books yet. I'm going to include it in the, because I had to separate a whole other portion on paradise, the sides of the north, and the mount of the congregation out of my book on the firmament because it was already too many pages. And if I would have included all of those chapters, it would have been well in excess of 700 pages. And so I decided to remove those 8 chapters, and we'll publish them again at some point and include all of this new information. But this is from First Clement, which is absolutely a confirming witness to what I just read from Solomon, and also a confirming witness for Enoch in his descriptions of these motions. It says this: "The heavens are moved by his direction and obey him in peace. Day and night accomplish the course assigned to them by him without hindrance one to another. The sun and the moon and the dancing stars, according to his appointment, circle in harmony within the bounds assigned to them without any swerving aside. The earth, bearing fruit in fulfillment of his will, at her proper seasons putteth forth the food that supplieth abundantly both men and beasts, and all living things which are thereupon, making no dissension, neither altering anything which he hath decreed. Moreover, the inscrutable depths of the abysses and the unutterable statures of the nether regions are constrained by the same ordinances." Now, remember when I told you about the oceans being in a ring, because this also is connected to that. "The basin of the boundless sea, gathered together by his workmanship into its reservoirs, passeth not the barriers wherewith it is surrounded, but even as he ordered it, so it doeth. For he said, so far shalt thou come, and thy waves shall be broken within thee. The ocean which is impassable for men, and the worlds beyond it, are directed by the same ordinances of the Master. The seasons of spring, summer, autumn, and winter give way in succession one to another in peace. The winds in their several quarters and their proper season fulfill their ministry without disturbance, and the ever-flowing fountains created for enjoyment and health without fail give their breasts which sustain the life for men. Yea, the smallest of living things come together in concord and peace. All these things the great creator and master of the universe ordered to be in peace and concord, doing good unto all things, but far beyond the rest unto us who have taken refuge in his compassionate mercies through our Lord Jesus Christ. And so you see how this verse and this passage is also describing the movements of the sun and the moon and the stars as being a circle in the heaven, which is exactly what Enoch and Solomon describes them, and how the oceans and the circle of the earth is described as a basin. When you look up that word basin, it is like a bowl. And so it is describing the earth as and the oceans being contained in a bowl, you know, not a ball or a globe or a sphere, but the oceans are contained in a bowl, in a basin, which is what gives sea level all across the earth, the flat plain of the earth. Sea level is where all the oceans come together and actually form one boundless ocean that is flat all the way to the horizon. And so, and then again, as we said, the upturned edges of the circle of the earth, the Antarctic ice wall, is what creates the barrier where the waves of the ocean are impassable, and that's where the waves are stayed. They cannot breach that particular boundary. And so it's a beautiful presentation, in my opinion.
Yeah, and the Epistle of First Clement was a first century document and a very authoritative one. Clement is mentioned in Scripture in Philippians 4 and 3 as a fellow laborer with the Apostle Paul. Philippians 4:3 says, "And I entreat thee also, true yoke fellow, help those women which labored with me in the gospel, with Clement also, and with the other, my fellow laborers, whose names are in the book of life." So we have a very authoritative witness there, and the consistency in these things are just amazing. They're all telling the same story from different sources, and it's a very clear and undeniable picture that we're getting here.
Yes, I fully agree. And as I said in the book of Enoch, and really it would take us more than even just the fullness the rest of the time remaining in this show to describe the Enoch's description of the movements of the sun. But basically he describes the same thing, just goes in very grand elaboration in discussing the movements of the sun in this circular movement as it moves back and forth between the Tropic of Cancer and the Tropic of Capricorn. And as I described it in my ninth book, where I decrypt all those chapters, and because I take every verse and every chapter from the book on the courses of the Heavenly Luminaries and explain it in detail according to what is being described and how it connects to these particular motions and these movements. And I explained that Enoch describes the first three gates, number 1, 2, and 3, that these gates are dividing the area between the Tropic of Capricorn and the equator. The first gate being directly above the Tropic of Capricorn, the second gate being in the middle, and the third gate being actually touching the equator. And then the fourth through the sixth gates are between the equator and the Tropic of Cancer. And the fourth gate is directly above the equator, the fifth gate in between the equator and the Tropic of Cancer, and the sixth gate actually touches the Tropic of Cancer. And so Enoch begins his description of the movements with the sun located between the third and the fourth gate, because that's where the vernal equinox occurs, and that's also where the sun is positioned for the very beginning of spring. And it's also important to note, as I described with Solomon in that particular short passage in Ecclesiastes, he names Nisan, and let me pull that up again. But it's important that he describes Nisan, Tammuz, Tishri, and Tibet, because again, those are the 4 months that the equinoxes and the solstices occur in. And what he is actually describing, and when you understand the way God's calendar is established and laid out, it's the vernal equinox, which begins the season of spring. The summer solstice begins the 3 months of summer. The autumnal equinox begins the 3 months of fall. And the winter solstice begins the 3 months of winter. And so that is the linear progression of the seasons. As Clement said, with the movement, the year as established by God, beginning with spring, moving into summer, fall, and then winter. And so all of these three, Clement, Solomon, and Enoch, are confirming witness for one another, and they are exactly describing the same thing as I speak about and decrypt, because Enoch gives it in great, great detail, also describing the division of the day and the night according to each one of the movements through the gates. Enoch divides the portion of day and night into 18 segments, which fits exactly with the particular, when it reaches the summer solstice, there's like twice as much daylight as there are nighttime. And, we all know that when it reaches the equinoxes, that the day and night are divided exactly in half, 11.9999 hours, according to Enoch's calculations, which we round that up to 12 hours. But it equally divides day and night. And then when it reaches the winter solstice, the night is twice as long as that of the day, which, again, only makes sense when you understand how the sun is moving and circling above the earth as foundation for the heavens, which are spread out as a curtain above it.
Very good. Very good. And let's put on the table the Book of Enoch, chapter 76. And now that we have a proper cosmological concept to understand this, let's press on to Enoch, chapter 76, and let's look at these 12 gates. And John, could you put the Dendera zodiac up on the screen for us, please?
Give me one second, David. Let me get it pulled up here. I had it pulled up a second ago, and I think I got it pulled up now. Give me one second. I'm sorry. I got a bunch of weird stuff going on.
You're getting that.
Here we go. Can you see that?
Very good. Yes. Thank you very much. And this Dendera zodiac, this was found in the Temple of Hathor in Egypt, and it's also where they found the Dendera light. Some of you might be familiar with that from the ancient alien documentaries of, and I believe it is some kind of an ancient technology that is described there. But I am going to read the Book of Enoch, chapter 76. Then we're going to look at this Dendera zodiac. And I believe we're going to see, just from looking at it, that this is describing the same thing. Now, Book of Enoch, chapter 76. And I saw the 12 wide openings in all the directions through which the winds come out and blow over the earth. Three of them are open in the forefront of the sky, three in the west, three in the right of the sky, and three on the left. In other words, the first three are those on the morning side, followed by three in the direction of the north. The last three are those on the left in the direction of the south, followed by three in the west. Through four of the openings blow out winds of blessing, and through eight of them blow out winds of pestilence. When they are sent in order to destroy the whole earth, the water upon her, all those who dwell upon her, and all those which exist in the waters and the dry land. And I was reading from the James H. Charlesworth translation of the Book of Enoch. Now, it's interesting here that there are 12 gates, 8 put out destruction, 4 put out blessing. Now, what is 1/3? That's 33%, isn't it? And this is the origin of the 33 degree concept. It comes from the influences that come forth through these gates in the heavenly realm. And in my mind, these gates can be no place but actually in the firmament, and they allow forces to pass from the third heaven into our world. Some of them are good, some of them are bad, and the 1/3 that are blessings, this is the original imitation of Satan, where he claims to be the real 33% blesser. And we know also that on the 33rd degree parallel on Mount Hermon, these are where the 200 watchers came down in the days of Jared. And look at this Dendera zodiac. And let me see that on the screen, Donna, if you will, please. And if you look at this, this perfectly depicts the gates of Enoch. And if you will notice, this also makes no sense unless you think of it in a flat earth cosmology as if looking down at it from above. And you'll see that in this, there are four goddess-like figures that are, you know, kind of a beautiful goddess type figure. And in between the four, and these represent the four good gates, and in between them, there are these two little troll-like figures with animal heads on that are facing one another. So you have portrayed here the eight gates that bring forth destruction and the four that bring forth blessing. And you can see that around the earth is this circle. And this circle represents the firmament around the earth. And these gates are pictured here as coming through the firmament. And all of the ancients understood. When you see this, this opens up the Egyptian symbolism. It opens up the Book of the Dead, because in the Book of the Dead, the Pharaoh wanted to descend into the heart of the earth, where he got a boat of all things, and he wanted to ascend above the firmament to sail upon the waters. And in the scripture, in the 104th Psalm, it says that the Lord layeth the beams of his chambers in the waters. And literally, the heavenly temple, as Zen said, where Polaris is, right at the top of the firmament, where God is looking down at us, this literally is laid in the waters of the heavenly firmament. And the Book of Revelation, it talks about the sea of glass. And it's literally a sea underneath this glass, where God can actually look down at us. And this is just an overwhelming thought to think about, that the Lord is there looking down upon us. Now, what becomes profoundly interesting is that all throughout Scripture, we see these gates opening and closing, either for blessing or either for destruction. Now, I'll give an example in the Book of Psalms. Let's read in the book of Psalms, chapter 78, and we'll begin in verse 22. And this is one of the examples where the Lord opens up the heavens for blessing. Psalm chapter 78, beginning in verse 22. Because they believed not in God and trusted not in his salvation, though he had commanded the clouds from above and opened the doors of heaven. He opened the doors of heaven and had rained down manna upon them to eat and had given them of the corn of heaven. Man did eat angels' food. He sent them meat to the full. And, you know, it's time, and when you really come to the place where you really believe what the Bible said, it really gets good that God actually opened one of these heavenly gates and sent food through the actual angel's food, through this actual gate that's described in the book of Enoch. And we know also that it works the other way also. We could give the obvious example of Noah's flood, and we know that scripture. And you see, this is what the ritual magic and conjurations were based upon. Just as you see the Zendera zodiac there, where the Egyptians represented the gates of Enoch, the blessing and the cursing, and astrology, as it was a conjuration of the ancients, just like the book of Enoch showed, the movements of the sun upon the flat face of the earth. You try to say that. The Dara zodiac represents the way that the constellations are reflected and their influences upon the earth. And this was the way that they tried to control these forces. Now, in the book of Genesis, chapter 7, verse 11 and 12, we know the scripture. In the 600th year of Noah's life, in the second month, the 17th day of the month, the same day were all the fountains of the great deep broken up, and the windows of heaven were opened. And what does the word of God say is above the firmament? The firmament separated the waters beneath the firmament from the waters above. In Psalm 104, I love this scripture, and this is a scripture that always puzzled me until I understood this cosmology. And in Psalm 104 and verse 3, it says, "Who layeth the beams of his chambers in the waters, who maketh the clouds his chariot, who walketh upon the wings of the wind." And yeah, that makes perfect sense now that we understand the firmament dividing the waters under the heaven from the waters above the heaven makes perfect sense. And we can see here from scripture that these gates of Enoch, that they can be for blessing or that they can be for judgment. And while the pagan peoples, they sought to manipulate these forces through magic and through conjuration and through their astrological projections, we as children of God can actually do this. Now, after I taught my lesson on opening the gates of Enoch, someone said, "Well, how do we do this?" And I said, "Well, why don't you ask me something I know how to do?" But I know what the Bible is saying here. And I know that the Word of God says that in the end time, God's remnant will understand how to do this. Now, let's look at a scripture in Job chapter 38. And we're going to understand binding and loosing here a little bit. What did Jesus say? He said, "Whatsoever you will bind on earth will be bound in heaven." And in Job chapter 38, and let's begin in about 31. "Canst thou bind the sweet influences of Pleiades?" Now, there are 12 gates in the book of Enoch. There are also 12 constellations. And if you would imagine the heavens as a big circle, it would be like 12 pieces of pie, and each constellation would represent the location of a gate. And it talks of here that there are sweet influences coming from Pleiades, one of the good gates, I would suppose. And it says, canst thou bind the sweet influence of the Pleiades or loose the bands of Orion? We bind or loose according to the good or bad influences, and we do this according to the authority of Jesus Christ, not according to conjuration. And this is something that has to be learned through the paradigm of experience. It's just like learning spiritual warfare from the very beginning. We understand that we have authority to bind unclean spirits and to cast them out. Well, we're just taking our warfare to another level. We're taking it to the second heaven, and we're understanding that there really are gates that let in good and bad influences, and that we can have something to say about it through the authority of Jesus Christ. Now, there's a prophecy here that, well, first let's go to the book of Enoch. Let's go to the book of Enoch, chapter 76 and verse 14. And I just love this. The book of Enoch, chapter 76, we'll read verse 14. And it says, thus the 12 openings of the four heavenly directions are completed. All their orders, all their evil effects, and all their beneficial effects have I revealed to you, O my son Methuselah. And according to the book of Enoch, the good and bad influences were revealed unto Methuselah. Now, I believe that God is going to reveal this understanding to God's people for warfare in the end of time. How are God's people going to survive? Well, how did they survive in the wilderness when the children of Israel were wandering? God literally opened a window in heaven and sent a manna, angels' food. The angels ate food above the firmament. So God just opened the firmament up, sent some down through the window, through the gate of Enoch. And if he did it then, he can do it now. Now, let's go to the book of Revelation. Revelation chapter 11. And, well, before we do that, let's go to James. I'll just read a couple more, and I want Zen to weigh back in here. And you know, one of the ways that you can understand if something is a genuine revelation from God, just like Zen, he did a teaching on the flat earth is key to decrypt the book of Enoch. He did it on Now You See TV. How long ago, Zen? A few months or?
I think it was At least a couple months back.
Couple months ago, and I listened to that and just didn't sink in. You know, it says, well, yeah, sounds good, but I didn't get it. But when I went back and read it through and sit with it a while, it started to make sense. And then the lights come on. And when something is a genuine revelation of God, it will lead to further revelation. And revelation will lead to revelation. And when you, oh, I see this, then, oh, I see that. And, oh, there's this over here. And bang, bang, bang. And the lights start to come on. And then you know you've got something that's going to take you somewhere where you want to go. Now, in the book of James, chapter 5, look at verse 17 and 18. And just like we need to take our scriptures on cosmology literally, we need to understand that we need to take the scriptures on spiritual warfare literally also. And to understand properly, this is something that I've really starting to get, and I'm just taking baby steps here. But I'm starting to understand to understand the spiritual world correctly, we have to understand the physical world correctly. And once we have a proper physical cosmology, the spiritual cosmology will fall in line. And understanding these gates of Enoch is a foundational concept of how the good and bad influences come into our world from outside of the firmament. Now, in James chapter 5, verse 17 and 18, Elias was a man subject to like passions as we are, and he prayed earnestly that it might not rain, and it rained not on the earth by the space of 3 years and 6 months, and he prayed again, and the heavens gave rain, and the earth brought forth her fruit. And literally, Elijah prayed and was able to shut down that window to where rain would not come through. And then he prayed again, and it was open. And that's amazing. But it says Elijah was a man subject to like passions as we are. He put his pants on just the same way that we do. Now, what is really challenging to me? We see Elijah do that. And in Revelation chapter 11, it talks about the two witnesses, which represent, in my opinion, the end time remnant of God. And I have a unique take on the two witnesses. I believe that the two witnesses are Enoch and Melchizedek. Little different take on that. But in Revelation chapter 11, verse 6, it says, speaking of the two witnesses, which not only represent two individuals, but they represent two groups of people and the two symbolic churches, the church of the poor and the church of the open door. Two of the seven churches were not rebuked. But listen to what it says. These have power to shut heaven. They have power to shut the heaven, that it rain not in the days of the prophecy, and have power over waters to turn them to blood and to smite the earth with all plagues as often as they will. It sounds to me like the end time remnant is going to come to the place where they understand this. Now, this is nothing less than miracle working power. And this is the ability that Jesus said that whatsoever we will bind on earth, we'll bind in heaven. And I believe it's time for us to take our spiritual warfare to another level, because we are going to have the supernatural provision and protection of God in this time we're entering into. And just as God is challenging us to take our scriptures on cosmology serious, I think he's also challenging us to take our scriptures on spiritual warfare seriously. And as we do so, and as we pray and seek God, I believe he is going to teach us these things in the spirit. And it doesn't matter. And you know, there's no book for this. You're not going to be able to go down to the Bible bookstore and get a spiritual warfare book on how to close and open the gates of Enoch. But it's in the Word of God. And it's laid out for us that from the most ancient times, these people had the understanding. It was revealed to Methuselah in the antediluvian times. And I believe that this is one of the important spiritual precepts that's being revealed to God's people, as it says in the book of Daniel, that in the last days, knowledge shall be increased.
Amen.
Go ahead, Brother Zen.
Well, I was just going to make a comment on how you were talking about both blessings and curses and judgments come. And I find it interesting that there's a passage from the Colburn Bible which talks about the destroyer, the dragon, which many of us equate as being Wormwood of Revelation 9, or whether you consider it Planet X or Nibiru or the whatever it is, that this particular destroyer in the Colburn Bible has come many times and been part of judgment that has been brought upon not only the fallen angels in the antediluvian times, but it also speaks about it as possibly having been part of the judgments which had occurred during the time of Exodus and also in a previous flood before that which had occurred during Noah's flood. And it also says in this particular passage that the vault of the heaven, the vaults of the heaven, had opened. So I'll just read this really quick. It says, the first sky monster was joined by another, which swallowed the tail of the one going before. But the two could not be seen at once. The sky monster reigned and raged above earth, doing battle to possess it, but the many-bladed sword of God cut them in pieces, and their falling bodies enlarged the land and the sea. Because, you know, we say in Revelation that a mountain of fire is thrown into the sea, and one-third of the ships, one-third of the creatures are destroyed. The water turns to blood. And it's interesting that this particular destroyer, it speaks about when it comes before, how it came with a red dust, and it spread a red dust upon the land. But anyways, I'll read a couple more passages. It says, in this manner, the first earth was destroyed by calamity, descending from out of the skies. The vaults of heaven had opened to bring forth monsters more fearsome than any that ever haunted the uneasy dreams of men. Men and their dwelling places were gone. Only sky boulders and red earth remained, where once there were, but amidst all the desolation, a few survived. For man is not easily destroyed. They crept out from caves and came down from the mountainsides. Their eyes were wild and their limbs trembled. Their bodies shook and their tongues lacked control. Their faces were twisted and the skin hung loose on their bones. They were as maddened wild beasts driven into an enclosure before flames. They knew no law, being deprived of all the wisdom they once had had, and those who had guided them were gone. The earth, only true altar of God, had offered up a sacrifice of life and sorrow to atone for the sins of mankind. And so this is talking about the first destruction, which we see that played out in chapter 1, verse 2, of the earth becoming without form and void, a deserted wasteland, an indistinguishable ruin. And then after that, we see the recreation of the earth into the present state that we find it in now. And so the judgments which were brought against the earth and also the fallen angels, I believe that even the drowning of Atlantis, it was destroyed when the vaults of heaven were opened and these sky boulders or sky monsters, just as wormwood, I believe, will be one of these particular objects that, in my opinion, with the wrath of God being poured out on those not written into the book of life at the end of days, that such judgment is also that the Most High allows whatever these objects are, whatever they may represent, to enter into the enclosed world system, and that just as he opened the windows of heaven to allow the floods, the waters above, to drown and to cover the tops of the mountains during the flood of Noah's day, and just as he opened the windows of heaven to allow the manna to come forth in order to feed Israel during the time of the Exodus, so does he also send these curses and the destruction, the judgment against either the rebel angels or to, you know, his people Israel for backsliding and getting involved in paganism. And so we see both being represented as coming through the vault of the heavens. And I also believe that at the end of days, where it speaks about the heavens being rolled up as a scroll, that this will be the firmament being open in order to allow, you know, Yeshua and the angels and the armies that come with him, that they will come down and through, and every eye will witness, every eye will see, and then, you know, every after the wrath of God, every knee shall bow and every tongue confess.
I think you're exactly right. And this passage from the Colburn Bible that Zen was reading, it's Egyptian, and it's Egyptian cosmology. And once again, when you get this proper understanding of a flat surface of the earth with the firmament as like a dome over it, when you read this and then you understand the gates of Enoch, but it just all makes perfect sense. And I identify the destroyer with the fallen celestial being, the Assyrian. And I believe that this is the correct understanding of planet X. This is what it will be.
Yes.
So I identify Rahab in the same manner. I believe Rahab is referring to a planet that is actually being moved by a fallen angel. And this is another real paradigm buster. And I know that Zen also holds the Book of Enoch in high regard. And the Book of Enoch itself says that it is meant to be a book for the last days, and that it will give us specific wisdom and understanding. And there's a specific portion in the Book of Enoch that talks about how the angels actually move the planets. And I did a teaching also on this just last week on FOJC Radio called The Book of Enoch and Wandering Planets. And I believe this is exactly what Rahab is going to be. And what it was, and I think here, as you talked about the destruction that took place in Genesis 1-2, when the earth became without form and void, that it was this type of disruption where the fallen angels, and it tells us this right in the Book of Enoch, that they refuse to obey their courses and that they move the planets in a way that God did not intend. And also, this is what's going to cause the signs of the sun and the moon as we enter into the last days. And I believe, I remember reading in one of your books, and I think it might be you were referring to the Book of Jubilees, chapter 6, maybe. But you were talking about and writing about how that the fallen angels actually tried to disrupt the seasons, to alter the calendar so that God's feast could not be observed at the proper time.
Yes. Yes. Yes, that's what I was writing about. Absolutely.
And I think that there's been much funny business. And, of course, it says about the beast that he is going to want to change times and seasons. And we know that the devil has his appointed times, just as God has his appointed times. And he wants to do everything to get us onto his times and off of God's times. But one more thing I want to throw out here as a concept is a fellow by the name of Ivan Sanderson. And he was a very fascinating fellow, and he come up with a theory called the 12 vial vortexes. And in Mr. Sanderson's theory, there were 12 places on the earth that had unusual amounts of electromagnetic energy. And these 12 places were places like the Bermuda Triangle, where there are strange things that happen. The place in off Japan, I can't think of the Devil Sea, and one of them,
Yonaguni.
Yes, thank you. And one of them is where the Indonesian airliner not long ago disappeared. And the History Channel did a documentary on this, the 12 vile vortexes of Ivan Sanderson's theory, and all kinds of strange things happened. And there was one man, and some of these vortexes are upon the land, and there was one man that was a scientist, and when he went to investigate this, his son was murdered by some type of an animal. And the History Channel documentary crew, they would tell crazy stories about, they would get into fights when they would go down there. People that were friends would get into fights with one another. It's almost like something you'd hear on the X-Files. But I want to ask Zen, and here's my takeaway from this. The Bible talks about the gates of hell. We know the scripture, Jesus said, the gates of hell will not prevail. And in the book of Jonah, it talks about the bars of the pit and the abyss. Now, I think it's an obvious correlation between the 12 gates of Enoch in the heavenlies and the 12 gates of hell that go into the underworld. And all of the ancient temples, Esagila, the Babylonian temple at Babylon, it had 12 gates in it. And archaeologists tell us that the Babylonian temple, the Esagila, that it is right down from where the Tower of Babel originally stood. And we know the story of the Tower of Babel, how it wanted to reach into heaven. And literally, the purpose of the Tower of Babel was to go through one of the gates of Enoch to rise above the firmament. This was the explicit purpose in the Egyptian Book of the Dead, that the Pharaoh, when he became a god, that he would ascend to the waters above the firmament. But do you think it's possible that there's a correlation between the 12 gates of Enoch and these 12 gates of the underworld?
Most certainly. And it describes this in many different places as, you know, the whole saying, as above, so below, that heaven and hell meet where the plane of the earth merges the two together, and that just as there are these openings and portals and windows in the heavenlies and in the firmament, so are there the same kind of things reflected in the underworld. And most certainly, I cover in the book, in my newest book, The Firmament, Vaulted Dome of the Earth, the chapter on the windows of heaven, I showed this correlation, the as above, so below, because the earth is the meeting place. This is why we have the duality of good and evil represented in the duplicity that we experience here, and that it is a merger of the goodness that is of heaven and the evil that is of hell. And are being born into flesh bodies, we are here to, again, redetermine our allegiance to serve one or the other, that we can't serve both masters, but that we have to decide in lifetime whether to serve the Most High God, the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, or Satan and the rebel angels in Legion, because this is the great contest. I'm writing a trilogy right now, a three-book set, The War in Heaven being the first portion, The Enmity Between the Seed Lines being the second, and then The War Against the Giants in Canaan Land as being the third portion. But this is the fullness of the story that unites The War in Heaven with the ongoing saga that is The Enmity Between the Seed of the Woman and the Seed of the Serpent, as it plays out between the wheat and the tares, the goat and the sheep, which will continue As Christ said in Matthew 13, let both grow together until the time of the end, when he would send his angels out as reapers to gather the tares for burning and the wheat for preservation. And this is what we see reflected, even the New World Order elites, they are of the seed of Cain. They are united to the pagan idolatry, even with the Pizzagate and the pedophilia and the ritual torture and murder, child victim sacrifice, all of that is connected to the differentiation, the distinction between the wheat and the tares, the goat and the sheep. And we see this all being played out in this world and reflected in what we see in current events even today.
And when we begin to get this picture, and this is just amazing to me, it just blows me away. But when we get this understanding, and clearly the Sumerians, the Babylonians, and the Egyptians, they understood that there was a connection between locations in the heaven and locations in the earth. And this understanding is what gave them the ability to lay out their ley lines and to understand the position upon the earth where these powers from the heavens were going to be the strongest. And it doesn't matter, and I know you well agree, that not only was there a world culture in the antediluvian world, but also in the pre-Adamite world of Genesis 1:1. And they all understood this principle, and it come through this understanding of the gates. And the book of Enoch said it was revealed unto Methuselah. The book of Revelation says God end times remnant's going to understand it. And I think it's time that the Lord wants us to understand this. Now, Mr. Sanderson said something here I want to ask you about, Zen, because I believe he had, as far as I know, he believed in the heliocentric globular cosmology. I don't believe he understood the true biblical cosmology, but this is what it says about Mr. Sanders' vortexes. It says, Sanderson's theory is that there are 12 vortices, whirlpools of electromagnetic aberrations, and these are at 72 degree intervals around the world. Now, is his calculation of the 72 degrees on a globular cosmology, is that correct according to the true biblical cosmology?
Well, in my opinion, the globe, the way that they have longitude and latitude established on the globe, that all of that fits with the circle of the earth. You just have to understand that instead of folding underneath and connecting as a southern point at the southern pole, that the southern latitudes are just spread out as a wider circle of the circle of the earth. And which is why when oceanographers and merchant marine, when they navigate the southern latitudes, they are off as far as degrees and latitude, because they are trying to apply it to spherical trigonometry, which does not work according to the earth as a, like a plate, as a dinner plate, as a circle, a wide circle. And that the northern latitudes, because they are closer to the North Pole as the center of the earthen plane, that they are shorter, and that they are, but as far as the degrees of latitude north of the equator and south of the equator, all of that still fits. It's just that it doesn't, the southern latitudes do not narrow to a point as, as depicted by the globe, and the merging of all the southern latitudes in the, as meeting in the southern pole, but that they extend to the edges of the firmament. And so the divisions are still correct and still apply, whether they meet according to, I'm not as, I can't fully say as to where the locations of these openings are according to, you know, his particular work and research, as I'm not familiar with it. But certainly the measurements of the southern and northern latitudes, they still apply. It's just the southern latitudes are the lower portion of what I, you know, again, I reference as the southern hemisphere plane. And the northern latitudes are the inner circle closer to the center of the North Pole as the center of the earthen plane. And so when you just, when you understand that we're basically looking at the latitudes, which, you know, is why circumnavigation is still possible. You're just going around the dinner plate rather than, you know, around the breadth of the globe. But it's all still possible, as depicted by, you know, again, the United Nations emblem for the world, as depicted on the United Nations flag. I mean, they know something that they are keeping an occult secret and keeping from the rest of the world. But for those of us that have come to understanding and have been brought to the truth of this as revelation, we know the secret that they are keeping from everyone, at the same time that they are, you know, basically teaching everybody the lies and the deception of the heliocentric worldview. They are secretly keeping and confiding amongst themselves the real earth as it is depicted in that particular emblem.
And when we realize that the number 72, the 72 degrees holds true, we have another amazing number there, the number 72, the number of fallen angels and Masonic Gnosticism, the number of stars in the dome of the Capitol, the apotheosis of George Washington with the 72 stars. And this is, I believe, how the original occultist came to understand the significance of the number 72, because they understood the 72 degrees of separation between these 12 areas of electromagnetic vortices that correlated to the 12 places in the sky. And I can begin to see how they calculated their ley lines based upon these different areas of energy. And the number 72 is huge in the occult. And
Can I add one thing to that too, David?
Just you went to, my brother.
In one of these, and I can't remember exactly which book it was, but it describes after the Tower of Babel and when all the people were separated into tribes and tongues,
yes,
that they were divided into 72 languages and scattered to 72 different countries or portions, apportioned of the circle of the earth. So that would also fit with that. And that, as you pointed out, a different angel was in control or assigned to that particular portion of both earth and sky.
And we can see again this paradigm of God setting 72 angels and Satan opposing that with the 72. And it just goes on and on and on. And we really begin to see a pattern of an understanding of spiritual warfare that comes out here that is just amazing. And it emphasizes also the importance of God's times and God's feasts, that
yes,
there's really something to this. There's really something to being obedient to those things. And the dark side, they understand there's really something to being obedient to their times also. There's really something to this. And this is a paradigm of understanding that I think once people begin to get a hold of it, it's going to snowball into deeper and deeper revelation. Now, Brother John, have we stirred up any questions in the chat?
Yes, I have. plenty of questions in there, and Donna's been helping me put them in here. Give me one second to reevaluate. I've been trying to moderate the YouTube chat. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Sorry about that. I've been trying to moderate the YouTube chat and look at questions at the same time. There's a lot of people watching, so the YouTube chat's moving very, very, very fast, and so I'm trying to stay on point with it. There's a lot of really good people in the YouTube chat tonight trying to make it, keep it that way, and haven't had to kick too many people, so it's been pretty good. But we got plenty of questions here, guys, so bear with me here. I'm going to see here. All right, so from Matt, I'm going to ask this first because he's been asking me on Facebook to ask you guys this, and this has nothing to do with the subject tonight, just so you know. But he's been asking me to ask it to you, and I told him I would, so I'm going to ask this first and get it out of the way. He says, I want to ask David and Zen about Dr. Frank Strange's and Valiant Thor.
I'm not too familiar with that. I did hear something about Valiant Thor as being one of these, you know, fallen angel extraterrestrials working with government. And it is my opinion that the governments of the world have been working and with the fallen angels for a very long time, and that they have been guided and taken over, just as it says in the Emerald Tablets, that these interdimensional serpent-headed creatures, that they took over the councils of the world by becoming embodied in the royals, those that sit on the thrones of the world. And so, and to me, it's nothing new under the sun, and that this Valiant Thor thing is just confirmation that the fallen angels have been given technology to the governments. And I believe Eisenhower signed some treaty allowing for certain peoples to be abducted as long as they receive technology, if I'm correct. And I'm not positive that Valiant Thor is connected to that, but it seems to be that they are working. Even Phil Schneider, in speaking about the deep underground bases, spoke about how they built upon already existing structures, and the Emerald Tablets talk about that as well, how they had established structures in very ancient times.
David, do you have anything on that?
Sure.
Okay. Well, let's get on to the next question then. We are going to go to question for David. How many books of Enoch are there, and what is the difference between them? Which one of them is right? And I guess this could go, David, you can answer first. Zen.
Well, there are three major books of Enoch, and the first one is the one that really has the authority. First Enoch is the one that was quoted by our Lord's half-brother in the book of Jude, and that is the one that really carries the water, in my opinion. And the other two, I'm not that familiar with. I'll let Zen run those down for us. And I know that the one, I believe it's 30, and it speaks of, or maybe second, speaks of Metatron, the angel of the whirlwind that was quoted by George Bush, which is a real illuminist flag that they threw out there. But I know that it's First Enoch that is the one that's really the one we want to pay attention to for the good side.
I agree that First Enoch is the authoritative, and as I show in my work with the showing how it is encoded with the same cosmology, the geocentric earth enclosed by a vaulted dome, that it is also, like the Bible, encoded with this truth, which to me shows that it is divinely inspired. Second Enoch, in my opinion, that the translator has tainted it with some heliocentric leanings, that even though Second Enoch, still like First Enoch, shows that there is still this geocentric Earth and the vaulted dome of the Earth encoded into the scripture. It has, whoever translated it from the Slavonic or translated it into the Slavonic long ago, and that translated into the English, somewhere along the way it got corrupted with heliocentric worldview, because there are certain things which contradict in that one. And it's my opinion that Enoch wrote it pure, but then it got corrupted by a translator along the way in trying to, and I believe that it reflects that that translation had to have been over the last 500 years, because it's only been over the last 500 years that we've embraced heliocentrism. But certainly a lot of the passages, or certain, some aspects of certain passages show that kind of tendency. As far as Third Enoch, it is a description of Enoch being transformed into the angel Metatron, and it's a revelation more towards, it's written according to revelation given to Rabbi Ishmael, and not something that was written or dictated by Enoch. It only talks about Enoch in his, describes him as being transformed into the angel Metatron. And so, and I'm not, even though that's a Hebrew text, I really think you have to be really careful with that one, because again, it doesn't have the divinely inspired aspects as the first two, which showed that the Enoch cosmology, according to as I decrypted it in the ninth book, Flat Earth, as key to decrypt the book of Enoch. But again, the second Enoch, you have to also be wary, because in my opinion, it's been tainted by a translation somewhere along the way.
All right, guys, I want to say something real quick in the chat on YouTube. Well, this is my final warning to you guys that insist on coming in here and trying to change the conversation to something about the Sabbath or something about the lawlessness and trying to teach lawlessness on my channel. I'm sorry. I'll block you, plain and simple. I've warned you several times. You keep doing it. Yeshua did not break God's commandments by healing somebody on the Sabbath. That is not God's commandments. If you look in the Torah and find that it is illegal to heal on God's Sabbath, then you have something. Until then, quit making up stuff and lying and saying that our Messiah is a lawbreaker, because if he was, he is the anti-Messiah, plain and simple. And I will block you. This is your last warning. I don't want to block you, but if you're going to come over here and try to be a soapbox preacher on the chat and distract everybody from the subject at hand, I will block you. Sorry, guys. Go ahead.
Yeah, no problem. Got to keep control.
Absolutely. If Jesus would have broke the law, Jesus would have been a sinner. And Jesus did no sin, neither was any guile found in his mouth. They're talking about somebody else.
Yeshua is the law.
Absolutely.
What's your question? Okay, sorry about that. I got sidetracked. Okay, so Seasider asks, John or John, can you ask David and Zen for us, does Satan still have standing or access to the throne room?
I don't believe so. I believe that he was banished to the inner part of the firmament, and that unless he is invited, if he is asked, and of course he has to serve and he has to come before the Most High God. But as far as the rebel angels and Satan, I believe that they were cast out, as I said, on the second day, as we covered in the show that we did on the war in heaven.
And I believe that Satan is bound now, which prevents him from entering our world and inhabiting flesh, and also prevents him from entering to the third heaven, where the Lord is. There are some fallen powers that do have access to the third heaven. We know this from the book of Ephesians because it says that we wrestle with principalities and powers in heavenly places. And that express phrase in the Greek is the same that's used in Hebrews 1:3, where it says that, in Ephesians 1:3, where we are blessed in all spiritual blessings in heavenly places. And if you follow that phrase through the book of Ephesians, it's used, I believe, five times. And it definitely shows that it's the throne of God where the Lord is. In Ephesians 2 and 6, it says we're seated with Christ in heavenly places, right at the right hand of the Father. So I would agree.
All right. Anything else to add to that, or do you want me to go ahead into the next question? Next question, please. You guys just tell me how it is, man. I've got 15 things going on at once here trying to...
You're multitasking, Brother John.
I'm not good at multitasking. That's one of the things I fail at massively. So, and I want to thank Donna, your wife, David, for relaying a lot of the questions from our chat into there. She did a really good job. And Donna, if you're listening, I know you are, please continue if there's any more. I appreciate it a ton. Jacob asks, sixth gate, the day after the spring equinox, or equilux, he says, and a question mark?
No, the sixth gate is when the sun reaches the Tropic of Cancer, because that is the highest most gate. The spring, the fourth gate is directly above the equator, and that's where the sun moves from the spring equinox, the vernal equinox. It moves into the fourth gate, and for 30 days remains in the fourth gate, and then for 30 days remains in the fifth gate, and then for 30 days remains in the sixth gate, and will reach on that 31st day, which is summer solstice, June 21st, that it will reach the Tropic of Cancer and then reverse course and begin moving back south. And then on the day after the summer solstice, it will enter again the sixth gate for 30 days, descend down through it, for 30 days after that, descend through the fifth gate, for 30 days after that, descend through the fourth gate. And then on that 31st day, which is September 21st, it will reach the equator again for the autumnal equinox. Then it will descend for 30 days into the third gate, 30 more days into the second gate, 30 more days into the first gate. And on that 31st day, the winter solstice will reach the Tropic of Capricorn and then reverse course and begin moving back north. And then it will spend 30 days in the first gate, 30 days in the second gate, and on that 30 days in the third gate, and on that 31st day, will reach the equator again on the spring equinox, which begins a new year and completes the cycle.
All right, next question, unless you guys have more to say here. Eric asks, if you get the chance, could you pose to Zen and Dave this question? In my research, I haven't been able to find an agreed-upon date or time period in which the book was probably written.
What book? The Book of Enoch?
I would imagine they're talking about the Book of Enoch.
It's my opinion that the Book of Enoch, as we have it, the first Book of Enoch, that it was passed down, and that even it's my opinion that it was with Noah and his sons, even like as it says that that Enoch had revealed all to Methuselah, and that Methuselah revealed gave it all to his sons, and that this continued and Noah carried it with him in the ark. Now whatever version we have that was translated into, the latest copy, into the English or whatever, from whatever copy, that it's my opinion that that is a copy of another copy of another copy, and that, in my opinion, because we do see encoded in the Book of Enoch, again, this that it's divinely inspired, that it had to have been a revelation given to Enoch by the angel Uriel, and that it was passed down and historically reached us in the way, in the shape, in the form that we have it in, because, as again, it is still encoded with the geocentric cosmology as revealed in the Bible, and both of them stand as a confirming witness to what God himself describes in Genesis, which we know he dictated this book to Moses, and that he gave him exactly what we have written in the timeline of Genesis, and also with the stories like in Joshua and Isaiah and others, which affirm the geocentric narrative and cosmology, the vaulted dome of the earth, all of that as being biblical truth. That's just my opinion, though.
When our Lord's half-brother quotes the Book of Enoch in the 14th verse of his epistle, when he said, "And Enoch also, the seventh from Adam, prophesied," he not only affirmed that the Book of Enoch was inspired, but he also affirmed that it was written by Enoch. And
amen.
This would necessitate, and I repeatedly enjoy saying, that the Book of Job and the Book of Enoch came across on the ark. And I believe that this is true. And in a lesson we did just last week called The Book of Enoch and Wandering Stars, I went into the statements that were made by Tertullian, who he died in 225 AD. And this shows that up into the 3rd century, in many areas, the Book of Enoch was considered scripture, and Tertullian went into a lengthy defense of the Book of Enoch as scripture. And one of the things he said, that the reason why the Jews rejected it is because it had too much Jesus in it, that the prophecies, the title that Jesus chose to use for himself was the Son of Man. There's only one reference to the Son of Man as a messianic title in the Book of Daniel, chapter 7, but this comes repeatedly from the Book of Enoch, and this is just another one of the very strong reasons of much more. A lot of people know about the sons of God and the daughters of men, but there's so much more that we could talk about the Book of Enoch that shows it to be a truly inspired book.
I agree. And I would say one last thing. I show in my 9th book, again, The Flat Earth as Key to Decrypt, the Book of Enoch, how even Adam was given the Book of Generations, the Book on the Heavens, just like and which I believe it was the Book on the Courses of the Heavenly Luminaries that Enoch also writes about, but that Adam also had been given 4 books, and he gave these to Enoch when he was 13, began to teach him from these books, and then Enoch passed them on to Noah, according to, there's a book, an extra biblical text called the Book of Asatir, which I believe is the secret book of Moses or something like that. And it describes Adam giving these books to Enoch and Enoch giving them. And I have those quotes in that book, so if people are interested.
I'm interested. I got my copy right here. Got mine right here.
Yeah, it's in there.
And it's brain candy, baby. It's brain candy. You want your little brain candy, get you one.
Well said, guys. You guys crack me up. Okay. So David asks, so does it teleport from east to west, or does it go in a circle?
It goes in a circle. It moves from east to west and then north to east. And that's basically describing a circle. And again, Enoch was looking down on the circle of the earth as if he were standing on the above Polaris on the vaulted dome of the earth. and being described the movements, which again, all the heavenly luminaries move in circle, just as is shown and revealed in the time-lapse photography of the movements of the heavens around Polaris, and also in what is referenced as the midnight sun as phenomena, which occurs when the sun reaches the Tropic of Cancer, and then for a period of 4 days and four nights, you can see it circle in from east to west to north to east in the skies without ever setting below the horizon. It remains for a short time because that's when its loop, its revolution in the skies is at its tightest and shortest. And for that particular, for almost a week, it will remain above the horizon. If you were at the North Pole, exactly at the North Pole, you would see the sun move as in steady in a straight line across the horizon. But because, you know, the we see the video of the midnight sun from different places, either south or a little bit off of the from the North Pole, we see the sun moving in circle up and down, but it still remains above the horizon, which shows that its movement across the skies and above and around the Earth is in a circle.
Anything to add to that, David?
No, sir.
All right, then, next question. Jacob asks, seriously have a question. Hanok describes the new year as the equinox. How do we apply equinox to his description?
The new year as the equinox.
Equinox describes the new year as the equinox. How do we apply equinox to his description?
Well, as I said earlier, I'm not sure what the equinox is, but the equinox, Enoch's calendar and God's calendar begins on the vernal equinox, and that begins the 3 months of spring. When it reaches the Tropic of Cancer for the summer solstice, that begins the 3 months of summer. When it reaches the autumnal equinox on the equator once more, that begins the 3 months of fall. When it reaches the winter solstice, that begins the 3 months of winter. And so when it reaches again the equinox for a vernal equinox, that begins the new year. And so you can see, and Enoch's calendar and the year is divided into 364 days. It takes the sun 30 days to move through each one of the six gates of heaven. And then you have four additional days for the two solstices and the two equinoxes, which is in total is 364 days.
Anything to add to that, David?
No, sir. Go right ahead.
All right. And this is the second part to Jacob's question. And second part, how would we determine equinox is not, or equinox in a city, not at the equator?
Well, you could just go to time and date and look and see what particular day it divides where you are, wherever, you know, in your area, when the night and the day are divided into 12 equal hours. And that would be the equinox for you.
All right, next question. Victoria asks, why can't the edges of the firmament be found?
They can, and in my belief, the Admiral Byrd actually found them and describes that, and also describes his planes having run into the outer edges of the firmament, and his planes were being destroyed, annihilated in mid-flight. And I described this in my new book, The Vaulted Dome of the Earth, The Firmament Vaulted Dome of the Earth, in chapter 5, I believe, on the I described that in great detail. And it is my opinion that he did find the edges because it was shortly after his return that they began Project Dominic and also Project Operation Fishbowl and began starting to nuke the firmament in order to see if they could breach it. in my opinion. David?
Just something that is absolutely theoretical, but I think that possibly the people at NASA, our good Freemason friends and occultists, perhaps have learned how to open one of the gates of Enoch in the firmament to pass through it. And maybe that's how they done some of the things that they did. But that's just purely theoretical, but I think it's definitely possible.
I think CERN is also about that there, that they are trying to get beyond.
Absolutely.
All right. Go ahead, David. Sorry.
I mean, that could be how some of the they're able to get past the firmament through occult knowledge and be opened the gates to pass through it.
Well, it certainly says in the Emerald Tablets that they were able to open up stargates and to invite into this plane and this dimensionality these very evil and dark entities. And which, again, I think that the whole process is being replicated by CERN.
It absolutely is. Absolutely.
All right, next question from Cott. Okay, there we go. For the pic Donna posted, does David know if the four gates of blessings correlate to any appointed times or feasts?
I would suspect that they do. And this is the importance of God's times. And we can pray anytime, but there are something special about God's times. And I would just say that I believe that that would be true.
I would agree, and I do believe that the rains, the way that the rains are established, that they are part of the blessings that are poured out. Because, again, the whole cycle of spring, summer, fall, and winter, precipitation is a big portion of that, as well as the sun's light. And I do believe that the sun is also a part of those blessings, and that that's what creates, you know, the harvest and the blooming during spring, the creation of food, and all of that is part of the blessings being poured out on the earth, and that the food then is a part of the blessings for the animals and creatures that live, that hear, and that need that food in order to sustain. And certainly good water, good air, and good food is part of the blessings of our existence here upon the earth plane.
Yeah, and I would believe that God's special times, new moon, Sabbath, and the feasts, that these are the times when the blessings of God are the strongest.
Yes.
Through the spiritual firmament. And that likewise, the satanic holidays.
Yes.
Christmas and Easter, these would be times, and Halloween, these would be times when the malevolent forces are the greatest. And our friend Bill has talked about the Thelemic calendar, and they go to great lengths to determine this. And what these people are doing, they're tapping into this ancient knowledge to get the very most that they can get out of these dark influences.
I would also add that the way that they establish these megalithic sites and structures on these specific ley lines, as David pointed out earlier, that is also part of creating and strengthening the rituals that they do on these particular days.
Absolutely. And we just talked not long ago with Timothy Alberino how that the Catholic churches are built right upon these underground caverns. And also our friend Bill Schneblin, he affirmed that the same is true in Mormonism. And, you know, the same is also true of Chinese temples. And, you know, this is universally true all over the world because this was universally understood, ancient knowledge in the antediluvian and the post-diluvian world.
Yes, absolutely.
All right, guys. Next question from Monder in Monder 01 in the YouTube chat. Please ask David what his thoughts and understanding is on the Pope closing the mercy door last week.
On the Pope closing the what?
The mercy door.
I'm not familiar with that. I'm sorry. Do you know about that, Zim?
No, I don't.
All right, but I can tell you this. The Pope has no power to close any mercy door, at least not the mercy door that we received through the Messiah. So I don't know exactly what the mercy door is in his opinion, but either way, we'll have to look into that. It's a pretty interesting question.
Yeah, it would be more likely the mercy door was shut on his little self.
Right.
Most likely. Okay, so next question is from Lanny. Polaris never moves. How do the rest of the constellations move around the flat Earth and not move?
They all move in circle. Because the Polaris, as the center of the vaulted dome, everything else moves in circles and spreads out to the very edges of the firmament. And so it describes the heavens, the firmament being divided into seven different portions, and each of those portions is said to be occupied by the seven planets of the universe, which include Mercury has the innermost closest to Polaris, and then it's Mercury and Venus and Mars, and then the Sun and Moon. The Moon too is also closest, has the lows and is near the Sun and the Moon are special because they move back and forth between the Tropic of Cancer and the Tropic of Capricorn, whereas the stars and the wandering stars specifically are apportioned to being moving in circle around Polaris, and they remain constant in that one revolution. They don't move back and forth across the tropics like the Sun and the Moon, but the Jupiter and Saturn are said to have the largest revolutions, and they are closest to the outer edges of the firmament. But Venus is said to have the closest revolution to that of the Sun, which is why it mimics the Sun and is visible either below or before or after sunrise or sunset, because it mimics almost precisely the revolution of the Sun. But again, the Sun moves back and forth between the Tropic of Cancer and Tropic of Capricorn, so it is shortening and lengthening its revolution as it does so, whereas Venus maintains one steady constant revolution, one circle around that of Polaris. But again, you can see with the time-lapse photography that all of the heavenly luminaries move in circle around Polaris.
Anything to add to that, David?
No, sir.
All right. Next question from Alec. Would the constellation of Pleiades be a gate too? In my culture, we're taught that's where we're from.
I have read that, actually, that Pleiades and also Orion, and how that plays out, perhaps, you know, because as David said, that each one of the different constellations, the different 12 houses of the zodiac, is said to hold a particular doorway, portal, gateway, window, whatever you want to call it, and whether it's connected to what constellation, what star formation, what we don't know, but certainly there seems to be affirmed in the scripture and also in the occult books these gateways connected to Orion's belt. Certainly Orion is depicted in great detail in many of the megalithic structures and their alignment with the belt of Orion, and so in my opinion it shows that there is this as above, so below connection, because the fallen angels always do mimic what they see in the stars and what they know of as the mysteries of the heavens. And they encode this into the layout of their megalithic sites and different megalithic temple complexes. David?
Oh, I agree absolutely. And in the book of Job, chapter 38, when he was asking, can you bind and loose the Pleiades and Orion, this is exactly what they were trying to do by aligning like the three pyramids in the Giza complex with the three stars in Orion's belt. They were literally trying to channel and bind and control these heavenly influences that were coming out of the gates of Enoch. And like Zen said, there's a correlation. You've got, there was 12 gates in the book of Enoch, and there are 12 constellations, each one corresponding to a gate. And when you see this paradigm, you can understand the cosmologies and also the attempts of these pagan cultures to manipulate these spiritual sources. And also the ability as God's people to have authority to bind and loose in the heavenly realm.
All right, guys, we have a lot of questions, so I'm going to, you guys okay to stick around for a little while? Because we do, I mean, I'm not even halfway through them, so it's up to you guys.
I'm good for a bit.
I am too.
All right, so Sean asks, just in the first book of Genesis, we find 10 dimensions, but the Father loves patterns, pun wordplay, and such, there are 12 of everything else. I wonder if the gates are doors to other dimensions, or am I way off?
We don't know. Could very well be. There certainly seems, just like with light, the spectrum of light, there are higher vibrations and frequencies of light that we are not able to see. And certainly they exist, like x-rays. You know, we use x-rays to see the skeletal body, to take a picture of the skeleton. But, of course, we can't see x-rays and we can't, but we can use them, and we know they exist. Same thing with gamma rays. And also with higher vibration and frequencies of sound, that dogs and certain animals are able to hear what we cannot hear. And so, yes, dimensions, things that we can't see, even right here. There was recently the discovery of a particular telescope that is connected to the higher light and bandwidth, and because of that, they are able to see what we cannot see with the naked eye. And so, yeah, in my opinion, there are dimensions are overlapped one upon another according to, you know, a higher frequency, higher vibration, and that light even steps down from the purest, which I believe is Yeshua, the Father, the Holy Spirit, in its purest form, and that as it slows in vibration, it settles into the different bandwidths, the different frequencies, and that what we see, even as physical dimensionality here in the third dimensional world, that really everything that we see, even though it seems concrete, is nothing more than atoms, protons, neutrons, and light and sound just slow down in vibration.
I absolutely agree. Absolutely. That, you know, we're talking very much the concept of portals and this type of thing. I absolutely agree.
All right, guys, next question. And also in the chat, once again, if you come on here and you're just here to bash, we're kicking you out. If you don't like this topic, then don't listen. This is as easy as that. There's no reason to come and bash people and call them names and stuff like that. It's kind of ridiculous, to be quite honest.
There's a nice man on cable TV wrestling an alligator. You know, you can go there and watch him if you don't like us. It's very therapeutic. I do it myself sometimes.
All right. Same here. Exactly. Go watch that if you this bothers you so bad. I mean, this is not this is research. This is interesting subject in my opinion. And I'm sorry if you don't like it. I understand, but you don't have to watch this show, and you definitely don't have to go in the chat and stir up people. So, anyways, next question from David: are stars portholes? Portals.
Are stars portals? Not necessarily. I wouldn't say that stars are portals. Would you, Zen?
No, I would say, you know, stars are connected to angelic entities, but not every star is a portal. Portals, windows, as we are talking about, they're special and they're not specific to every star. Now, certainly, you know, as we said about Orion's Belt or Pleiades or others, certainly there could be some stars and some constellations which are connected to portals, but I don't believe that every star is a portal at all.
No, I wouldn't either.
All right, guys, next question from Annie. If it was on his thigh, wouldn't it be like a tattoo? I've read that the word for thigh is very much like the word for banner, and banner makes more sense. So is this a scribal error?
I'm not sure what she's talking about.
I think she's talking about the name written on Yeshua when he returns, the name written that no man knows. I don't know. Maybe I pulled that out of the chat and she was talking to somebody else. That might be my fault on that question, but I think that's what she's referring to, the name on written on his thigh that no man knows.
Well, you can bet, however it was, that Jesus didn't do it in such a way that was going to violate the law.
Amen.
Guarantee that.
Yeah, I don't know that they have tattoo artists in heaven, but
right.
I don't think so.
You never know, I guess. They might have old, what was that guy's name? Jerry Sailor. Sailor Jerry up there tattooing people. You never know.
Well, Sailor Jerry might be somewhere else tattooing. We don't know.
Very true. Okay, so from Van Leer, could the 12 gates of heaven connect to the gates to connect to the gates of the sum? I'm not sure what he means by that. The sum, S-O-M-E. Maybe that was a typo. Maybe you guys know what he meant.
Gates of the sum, S-O-M-E. I'm not positive what he's talking about.
Okay. Donna asks, sorry, not Donna, this is Alec, and I think I skipped over a ton of questions here. Sorry. Okay, Jesse asks, let me go back here. All right, there's so many questions, I've skipped over a bunch on accident. Okay, Martha asks, question for Zen. So is Nibiru a star or a fallen entity?
I think it's both. And again, stars are connected to angelic powers, and that their courses are determined by them. And so I would say that it's both. And how that plays out, it's called the destroyer. It's spoken of as being, in my opinion, that wormwood might have association with it. But that also, I believe, that Apollyon Abaddon, and the angel that comes to release the other stars from the bottomless pit, and that the other stars fall into the earth, that they are also representative of angelic entities. They're certainly not stars as in what NASA teaches us as being, you know, entire suns, you know, with the sun being the center of the solar system, because if the earth were as small in proportion as that to the sun, one of these stars crashing to the earth would completely devastate and destroy us. So it certainly isn't that.
All right, guys. Or David, did you have anything to add to that?
I would agree, and I believe in Scripture, Rahab is a planet, and it's also a fallen power. And I believe, like the destroyer that has been alluded to in the passage in the Colburn Bible, I believe that it is not only a celestial body, but also that it will be the fallen entity known in Scripture as the Assyrian. And I think this is the true concept of Planet X.
I agree.
All right, next question here. Give me 1 second to filter through these here. Martha asked, Abaddon, the destroyer, is in the Old Testament and the book of Job. Is this Nimrod?
I believe it's going to be an angelic power. Now, it could be the same kind of spirit that both Cain and Nimrod and others that are part of that, those powers that are fallen and that serve the dark side. But Nimrod specifically as entity, I don't believe so. Nimrod's dead. David?
I agree, absolutely. And Revelation 9:11 says the angel over the bottomless pit, in Hebrew is Abaddon, in the Greek is Apollyon. And I believe that this will be the fallen entity the Scripture speaks of as the Assyrian.
Yeah, I agree.
Okay. Victoria asked, or no, I'm sorry, Alec asked, is there a new star constellation found in 2010, a 13th zodiac?
It wasn't just, I mean, they have this even depicted on the Dendera. That's that particular constellation is called something Ophicus or something, which means the serpent. It's associated to the serpent, and it's the 13th constellation. In a lot of the older cosmologies, they have this incorporated, and even though it's not always depicted as part of the zodiac, because most of them divide the constellation into 12, certainly it is found even depicted in the Dendera temple on the ceiling that shows the zodiac. David?
Absolutely, I agree.
All right, next question from Victoria. Do you think the elite know where these gates are, both kinds, and I bet they have structures built there?
Yeah, I think that's why they built CERN where it was. From what I understand, it was built on an already occultic site. If I don't remember the exact details, but even like, again, the megalithic sites where they construct them, they know that there is power there according to the as above, so below, which is why they construct them there and why they continue to build on top of already ancient sites, because they know that historically, going back to antediluvian times, those places were said to be aligned to the powers of the heavens, the mysteries of the heavens.
Absolutely, they know where they are. And everything that we study, it shows that in the antediluvian world, the pre-Adamite world, that they have been building structures on these locations for a long time. And you better believe they know it and they understand these principles.
All right, next question from Donna, why is it important for us to understand this info about the Gates of Enoch?
Well, in my opinion, it helps us to understand where we are in the cosmology, as well as it helps us to understand that we truly were made in the image of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, and that the earth was created special. And it takes us away from the lies of the Darwinian heliocentric worldview, which has basically led astray most of the world into believing that we have evolved to monkeys, and also that that in the coming deception that the ancient aliens are our creators. Once you know that the Bible is absolutely true and that all that God inspired and dictated to Moses through the gospel is true, you can go there for your answers rather than relying on astrophysicists, the neoteric priests of Baal, scientists, and all the NASA heliocentrists for answer as to who we are, where we are, and what all of this is really all about.
It not only helps us to understand physical cosmology, but also spiritual cosmology.
Amen.
And gives us a paradigm from which to wage spiritual warfare. And this has to be learned experientially. And I want to hear back from some of you spiritual warriors that when you begin to incorporate this into your prayer life, and I believe that the Lord is going to honor it because it's a true and a valid principle.
Amen. Also, it helps us to pinpoint that God is seated right above Polaris, that he has established his heavenly throne, and that all the visions, John seeing God seated on his throne with a sea of glass beneath him, in Exodus when Moses sees him seated on his throne, seated on a paved work, all of this is referencing his throne being established right above the firmament, right above Polaris on the top of the vaulted dome, which is the ceiling for our firmament.
Amen.
All right, guys. Next question from Jesse asks, does shutting the Mercy door have anything to do with these gates? I think we kind of, you know, touched on that. I mean, do you guys have any thoughts on that? We did talk about the Mercy door, not exactly knowing but do you guys have any thoughts on that particular statement?
I don't know what the Mercy door is. I can't really comment.
I'm not sure. It has to do with the Vatican concept of the Jubilee year, and everything they do is a perversion, and it just is a Luciferian perversion and an attempt to manipulate things in a way that God never sanctioned and doesn't approve of.
All right, next question from Paul. I have a question. Who was the master that Admiral Byrd spoke with in the Crystal City?
I'm not exactly positive, but I do know that in studying Asgard and the mythologies connected to Shambhala and others, that they describe a king of the world. And in my opinion, that would have to be Satan, because he is the king of this world, you know. And so whether that's true or not, I don't know, but I would say that Satan is the power and the principality, the ruler of darkness and the wickedness in high places of this world. But whether Admiral Byrd spoke to him or not, I have no idea.
Would agree.
All right, let me get back to here. Okay, so Ian asks, is this biblical earth stuff something that we should kind of keep to ourselves if it has the possibility of causing dissent between brothers? Or is this heliocentric understanding a form of pagan sun god worship that we need to be warned about?
Heliocentrism is absolutely pagan worship. And it is Lucifer establishing himself, creating, exalting his throne above the stars and clouds of God, and being like the Most High. The worship of the sun, reverence of the sun in heliocentrism, the replacement of the earth as the geocentric center of the world cosmology, all of that is pagan, and it's the counterfeit, the establishment of a counterfeit system to replace what is real and that which was dictated and given to us by God within the scriptures. And so absolutely it is the pagan counterfeit system of him establishing himself as being like the Most High, in my opinion.
And it certainly is a very, very important truth, as just our brief discussion tonight about it would let you know. But also we have to understand that whatever truth we understand, that it hasn't been that long ago that I didn't understand this at all, not even a year ago. And my initial reaction to this would be, I am never going to believe that. And has to put it upon the heart to hunger and thirst after knowledge, to seek after knowledge like silver. And it's the type of thing that if we will encourage people to study this, and I, in whatever area of whatever I believe, I am open to studying and learning more depth of the Word of God. And someone criticized me one time and says, well, boy, you've changed your position to what you used to believe when I knew you before. And I said, well, thank God. You know, I might change mine again if I can learn some deeper truth from the Word of God. So I think that it just speaks to the attitude that we all should have, to be open to continually growing and learning. And there is just so much that the Lord has for us. And I think we're living in that season when the Lord is pouring out knowledge, because I think it's the we're in that fig tree season. We're in that Daniel 12 season where knowledge is being increased. So just encourage people to go after everything that the Lord has for us, because he truly has much. And do it in a way that's not haughty or not condemning, and not in a way that's going to disfellowship or alienate people.
Amen. I would also say that, you know, the scriptures say it's the glory of God to conceal the matter, the glory of kings to go and search it out, that we have to honor people for where they are and realize that this is a very tentative and very touchy subject, and that if people aren't open to it, there's no sense harping on it, that all you'll do is alienate them and cause them to be hostile towards you, and that certainly won't make them receptive in any way or open them to the possibilities of this. For people that are seeking truth in this regard and that want to know more, we are to plant the seeds, and when they come for answer and come for guidance and direction on these particular topics, that we certainly then can give them answer to what they are seeking and encourage them to continue their growth and seeking out truth. But, you know, the Bible also warns us to not throw the pearls before the swine. And so don't try to force anybody into accepting this or making it important as an area of research for them, or in, you know, because we all want our loved ones, our parents, our children to consider this important and to know the truth of it. But if they're not willing and they're not receptive, don't try to force feed them, and don't try to rip open their head so you can pour this knowledge into them, because it doesn't work like that. Just plant seeds, give them milk when they're interested and they come for the meat, then give them that too. But, you know, again, be careful who you go to with this as revelation, because most people aren't receptive to it, and all they're going to do is judge you and label you as crazy, like they do me.
Very well said, guys, and it's so important to not break fellowship over this subject, because it wasn't long ago that most, I don't know, probably not many of us here have been believing this for over a year, and you know, we have very good friends that do not believe it, and we do not break fellowship with them, because this is not one of those things. I mean, there's only in the Bible, there's several things that cause us to break fellowship, and believing the shape of the earth as being one way or another is not one of them. And so and that's why we do shows about this, because we're not here to bash people in the head with this stuff. I mean, not at all. We're just talking about it, and we're enjoying our talk, and we're learning and trying our best. And like David said earlier, yeah, our views can change over time. That's how a person that is open to the truth, that's how they work. I mean, if you don't change your views ever in your whole life, that means you haven't learned anything. I mean, nobody knows everything right off the bat. Not one person that's born on this earth other than Yeshua knew everything off the bat. No, nobody. So there you go.
Amen.
Amen.
Next question from Sean. Ask for me what either one of them think about Satan moving through time, like in Job, when he says he's moving back and forth upon the earth.
Through time, or do you mean like dimensionality? Because it's my opinion that when Yeshua, for the first resurrection, that he then locked Satan up, gave him over to hell and to Tartarus, as it says, you know, as we read in that book on the Gospel of Bartholomew and Nicodemus, where we talked about the first resurrection. And so in my opinion, he's confined, and it says in the Kevra Nagas that he can certainly influence our thoughts, but that he's not roaming free. But there will be a time when he will be released again, according to Scripture. David, do you have a comment on that?
I would agree.
All right, guys. We're getting there. We're getting there. Donna keeps adding.
All right.
Donna keeps adding them on air from the chat. Thank you, Donna, for doing this for me, because it's impossible to take care of both chats at the same time. I usually do not moderate the YouTube chat, but there's a lot of really good people in there, and you guys, David does a great job hosting the show, and Zen does a great job. And so I'm able to
do. We just want to say what great listeners we have on Now You See TV and viewers, and we just really appreciate you so very much. We really do.
Amen. And thank you, Donna, for being such an awesome moderator, too.
Yes, thank you. Thank you very much. Now, the next question is, which gate did the sun just pass through for the 10th month? And what day of the year are we on, day 276 or day 268?
The sun is in the first gate. And the end of the year, the 364th day, would be when the sun crosses back into the vernal equinox. The what would be, because each season has 91 days. So when the sun reaches the Tropic of Capricorn for the winter solstice, that will be the 273rd day. And then it will take 91 days more to get to the equator for the vernal equinox, and then that will begin the new year. But when, and we're, the sun is in the first gate right now, because it is descending down towards the Tropic of Capricorn, which will be on December 22nd. On December 22nd, it will reach the Tropic of Capricorn and reverse course and begin moving back up through the first gate. It will take 30 days to move through the first gate, 30 days to move through the second gate, and 30 days to move through the third gate. On that 91st day, it will reach the equator. That will be the beginning of the new year, and that will be the 364th day of the year.
All right. Unless you have something to add, we'll go to the next question, David.
Go right on.
This is from Dolores. Do the gates of heaven correlate to places on earth where Jacob seen angels ascending and descending, as well as places like Mount Graham in Arizona, where American Indians say is the gateway?
Well, I do think that some of these native places where they've seen angels, just like Mount Hermon, that these different places are where the angels have come down. But as far as the ladder of Jacob, it's my opinion that this is actually found at the North Pole, and that there there is an opening which leads up to the throne room of God and also down into Sheol. That there's, it's like an elevator that you have these, where you can go up into the heavens and down, and that when the angels leave the throne room of God, they actually come down from where Polaris is and come down towards where, that this is called the Mount of the Congregation. In Isaiah 14, Lucifer references this as being where the throne of God is located, in the sides of the north. That when you understand that the north is only one direction, and it all meets, that all of the directions meet at the North Pole, that that is the sides of the north, and that's where it, the North Pole connects directly with Polaris. Polaris is directly above the North Pole, and the God's throne is directly above Polaris, and that this is where Jacob's ladder is, just in my opinion. But this is not, does not mean that angels have not come down in other places like Mount Graham, Mount Shasta, Mount Hermon, and other places, that certainly there has been angelic interaction with humanity in many different places. But as far as the one specific, that we see this also represented in the Taurus fields, and the plasma field experiments, you can look those up on YouTube. It shows an opening in the North Pole and also in the interior of the Earth, as above, so below, that that's also where the entrance into Sheol is. And Job describes this as, in chapter 26, as the place where hell remains naked beneath. And there's an opening there. This is also, in my opinion, where the where the whirlpool, which drains down into the interior of the earth, is located, that it is, and that's the cause of the tides, is this this whirlpool, that it, every 6 hours it reverses course. It will drain all the oceans of the world into the interior of Sheol, and then 6 hours later it will spit up all the waters of the oceans and for high tide. That's why we have two low tides and two high tides during the course of a day. And all of that is located in the center of the earth plane at the North Pole. And so that's why I believe that Jacob's ladder is referenced and located in that particular place.
I have had some very similar thoughts, and I have been studying Jacob's ladder, and I don't have all of my conclusions formulated, but in the Egyptian Book of the Dead, what the Pharaoh would pass into the heart of the earth before he would ascend into the heavenlies with his boat. And this would make sense when we understand proper cosmology of, as Zen stated, the heart of the earth being connected with the North Pole. So there's something to this, and there's an understanding here that there's just a lot more I think we're going to figure out as we begin to look at things with the proper cosmology.
I agree. I think a lot of things become revealed when you understand it in the way that it really is.
You start looking in the right places instead of the wrong places.
Right.
All right, next question from M. Joe. When was the additional material added by the angel? Do either of the guests know what year the angel, this is in quotations, did this, and what chapters in the Book of Enoch became tainted?
If you're talking about the second Book of Enoch, it's not the angel which tainted it, it's the translators which tainted it. The revelation, in my opinion, there was a time when second Enoch was pure, just like first Enoch. But because some heliocentrists tried to interject his understanding of the creation into the second book of Enoch in some of the descriptions, like it, there's a 365-day year described in the second book of Enoch, whereas in the first book of Enoch, there's a 364-day year. And the both of them describe the movement of the sun in a circular rotation. Like in the second book of Enoch, it describes it, I believe it's in verse 20, chapter 29, somewhere thereabouts. He describes the movement of the sun from east to west and then back from west to east, which again is describing a circular movement when you understand. Because it's only in describing this movement of the sun in a circle that it can go from east to west and then back from west to east. And so Second Enoch is encoded with the same geocentric cosmology as First Enoch. But again, I believe in like chapter 16 on the movement of the sun, that specifically in that particular chapter describing the fourth heaven and the movement of the sun and the moon, that there are some heliocentric tainting of the actual scriptures in a heliocentric way. And so that's the only problem I have with the second book of Enoch, which, you know, what other places was the translator interjecting his own opinions and his own belief systems upon the passages in the scriptures? We don't know. I do have a copy of the original Slavonic translation, and I'm trying to look at these specific words to see what particular passages and what particular words were corrupted, but I have not yet had a full time to do that examination. But at some point I do plan on doing that, and I will be able to narrow it in more detail for you. But as of right now, I can only say those particular passages and chapters which describe the motions of the sun and also describing some the 365-day year, that those are absolutely corruptions.
And it wasn't an angel, it was a little human stinker that did it.
Exactly.
It had to be fairly recent, since the days of Copernicus.
Right, exactly.
All right, fellas, next question. And we are getting through them, and so we got about five or six more left. You guys game? We're rounding 3 hours. This is a long show, but it's very, very interesting. We got a lot of people sticking with us. So Van Leer asks, could the 12 gates of heaven connect to the gates? Okay, this is the same question I just asked, the gates of some. That doesn't make sense. Okay. Alec says, on sound vibrations, would Genesis 1:3 be explained by sonoluminescence? Sonoluminescence.
I do believe so, that you can't separate them, and that when, because as I explained, Christ is the light of the world, and when he was called forth by the Father, and when he said, let there be light, this is when the creation became visible. I'm writing my next book, the first part of this trilogy, The Great Contest, The War in Heaven, about this and explaining this in more in greater detail. But that's when the creation became visible, and that's when light in its purest form spread out from Yeshua as source. And then, you know, everything, light stepping down in vibration, and also it says basically that Christ as the Word, as the memra of the Lord God, he sang the creation into being. And that to me is, you know, light stepping down in vibration from the, like the gamma ray, X-ray, the higher spectrum of light is slowing in vibration to formulate all the other aspects of creation. But that certainly in its purest form, the whole entire universe, which means one verse, it's all light, and it's all from Yeshua, just like John says that everything was made by him and is of him, and nothing exists without him.
Yeah, I love that. That is so cool.
All right, guys. One more warning for the chat. Stay on topic, please. We're not here to debate the law versus all these different things. This is not the show's about. We do have shows about that we talk about that stuff, and you guys are welcome to come and talk then about this. But we are trying to stay on topic because people are enjoying this topic. We're trying to discuss this particular subject. And even though it's a great topic to discuss and debate, it's really disturbing people in the chat because that's not what we're here to do. Next question. This question, you kind of guys kind of answered this already, so I'm not going to ask it. Basically, is Nibiru not a planet? And you guys already answered that. And if you wanted to go back in the show, you could. But if you want to say anything more about it, let me know. If not, say next question.
Next question. Next question.
Okay. Might the gates, this is from MJO, might the gates provide an opening to time travel, astral projection, etc.?
Yes, absolutely. Again, that these doorways, they're dimensional, and just like the occultists, they teach about the astral projection and even the remote viewing, that they are doing some kind of, outer body, inner mind, dimensional type of traveling in order to see what they see. Just like with Nostradamus, when he was scrying into the water or the mirror or whatever he was using to see and to gain access to his visions, that the occult and those people that are doing rituals in that way, and even with utilizing certain psychedelics, that they are doing that kind of thing. But they are opening themselves to powers and spiritual wickedness that they can't understand. And certainly, just like with the Ouija board, because the other side, they see when you open those doors, and they're going to come running to you, just like those people that say they can speak to, the dead or whatever. If the dead know that they can do those kind of things, they're going to come running. And so you are opening yourself up to things that you cannot yet understand. And so that's why you have to be careful. And that's why Christ tells us to not do those things, so that we don't open ourselves to being possessed in that kind of way. And, those people that go and do EVP sessions at graveyards and stuff, they will often come home with spirits and not be able to, then they'll have to go to people like David for deliverance.
Yeah, absolutely. And what these people try to do and can only do in a very limited way, the Lord does in an absolutely profound way. In the book of Revelation, and a lot of people that are abused, they always ask, well, where was Jesus at when I was being abused? And in the book of Revelation, it talks about the Lamb as having been slain, and that literally means slain in the continuous sense. In other words, Jesus is still being slain, and that doesn't mean that Jesus is still on the cross and hasn't come down, but what that means is the cross transcends all time and eternity. And even though the cross took place in 34 AD, when we place our faith in that, we die with him, Scripture says, and we enter into co-crucifixion with Christ just as if we were dying with him in real time. And the cross transcends all time. And this is because of the ability of God to be the Alpha and Omega. He can stand at both ends of time at the same time. And this is the amazing revelation of the cross. And this is what the evil one tries so imperfectly to imitate.
Very well said. So well said that I don't have anything to add. Okay, Nathan says, if this is close enough to the subject, can you ask David and Zen what do you think of Higgs boson, AZ, scientists are claiming it is the source of gravity?
Well, gravity, in the way that they interpret it, I don't believe that it exists in that particular manner. That what we see as gravity is really density, and not that the Earth is, because of its mass, attracting us. Because how is it that the Earth is holding in the oceans with gravity, and then at the same time will allow a butterfly to fly off into the sky? All of that doesn't make sense to me. And again, it's all density and buoyancy, which is a whole different kind of concept. But as far as the Higgs boson, in my opinion, what they are doing at CERN and whatever excuse they are using to do that, that they are trying to create Big Bang, the replication of the Big Bang, and that they are doing so in order to open up Stargate. And that they are doing that in order to invite evil interdimensional beings and entities into this time frame. And that the Most High had at one time restrained them from doing this and brought judgment against Atlantis for doing this same thing. But that in this time, since we're at the end of the days, he's going to allow them to do it. And I believe he's going to allow them to accomplish what they are doing, and then they are going to see, they're going to wonder after the beast, and then they are going to be judged by the entities that they are inviting and that they are conjuring and that they are trying to bring into the world, that those beings are going to bring destruction, and they're going to bring judgment against those not written into the book life, and that God is going to give them exactly what they are trying to achieve.
Yeah, I would agree. Absolutely.
All right, next question from Martha. How do you incorporate in prayer?
I use prayer every day, and I try to live prayer, not just do it. But every time I do eat, drink, just waking up every day before going to bed, I just give thanks and praise and honor to the Most High in all moments of being, because I know that we are not promised any more tomorrows. We may not wake up tomorrow, and that this very moment could be our last. And so I try to show gratitude and thanksgiving in for the blessings of every moment. And so I try to live prayer, and that I find that in living prayer, that that's what real church is, that it's about, you know, the kingdom of heaven is within, Christ is within, our connection to him is within, and that is in every moment, not just every Sunday or one day a week or, you know, one moment out of 7 days, anything. I try to live prayer, and that to me is my church. The moment is my church.
Amen. Would you repeat that question, John?
How do you incorporate prayer? Incorporate in prayer. How do you incorporate in prayer?
Okay, I'm not sure.
Prayer about the gates.
Oh, Donna's saying prayer about the gates. Well.
Oh, sorry.
Okay. We pray with understanding, just like we do with anything else. It's just like as you begin to minister in deliverance, you understand that you have authority over the devils in the first heaven, that we can cast them out. And we just extend this understanding to the second heaven in what we're learning in the binding and the loosing. And this is something that I have only begun to understand within 2 weeks, and it's that fresh to me, and it's something that I am going to learn by doing. And this is how you have to do when you understand the spiritual realm. It's one thing to read about it on the page of scripture, and it's another thing to actually do it. we don't need to be afraid of the supernatural. The Bible is an experiential book. It's a relationship with God that we experience. Being born again is an experience. Old things pass away. All things become new. Being filled with the Spirit is an experience that has to have emotions attached to it. We don't have to be afraid of emotions. We need to be afraid of emotionalism, but we don't have to be afraid of experiencing God. And when the Bible says we are seated with him in heavenly places, and that Psalm 91:1, he that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty, I'm not talking about guided imagery. I'm not talking about visualization. But I am talking about faith, faith that's firmly rooted in the object of Scripture. But our faith will become experience as we exercise our faith. And that's what we're going to have to do in this realm. We're going to have to launch out and learn how to do this. And you're not going to go down, I guarantee you, the Bible bookstore and find a book on how to do this, because this is something that the Lord is revealing, and it's something that we're going to learn how to do.
Amen.
All right. Joshua, okay, hold on. Okay, Petra asks, where can I look for a genuine Book of Enoch, Book of Jubilee, Ezra's Jasher, Book of Philo, Book of Josephus, Apocrypha, and the Dead Sea Scrolls?
You can go to sacredtext.com, and most of those are available there freely online.
And if you're wanting a hard copy, and I have a book here that has a bunch. It's called The Old Testament Pseudepigrapha by James H. Charlesworth. And I'll hold that up there. It's a two-volume set, and you can get it through Christian book distributors, very good sometimes, on sale. And it's got all kinds of stuff in there, an amazing collection of books in it.
Two of my most favorite books, and I've read those extensively. And yes, I do recommend those for anybody that wants all of these different texts. I believe most of them are included in both volumes. And much, much more.
Indeed.
Indeed, indeed. And somebody said the Book of Enoch is not inspired and it doesn't bring edification. I would say that that is a big joke, and you've never read it, or you're listening to the wrong spirit. So move on from that. Joshua says, this is the last question, by the way. There's probably more, but this is the last one I'm doing. It's 1 o'clock in the morning here.
At 1 o'clock, it is the end of days.
It's 2 a.m. here.
Yeah, so it's getting late, guys, and we're on our last leg here. And I just want to say that the audience has been great. There are obviously a few here and there that aren't all there. But other than that, everybody has been awesome. It's been a great audience. And so here is the last question. And after that, right after this last question, Zen, I want you to, Zen and David both, please tell people where they can find you, where they can get your information, et cetera. So we'll ask this question first and go right into that, guys. Joshua says, any insights into correlation with the prince of the air, the king of the earth, and the ruler of the underworld found in mythology and stories like Admiral Byrd's?
Again, it's my opinion that they are all the same being, that that Satan is the prince of this world, that he and his rebel angels being cast out, that they have temporary reign, and you know, until Yeshua comes again, and that will end the contest. David, you want to comment and then give out your information, then I'll give out mine.
I would agree with what Zen said there, and I just want to thank you, Zen, for coming on and doing 3 hours of hard work tonight, and by blessing me and all the listeners with your your study and your insight. Thank you so very much. I appreciate it, and I know the listeners do too. And thank you to all the Now You See TV listeners for having such an interest and a hunger to look into this and all the topics that you like to look into. And just a thanks to Don and John and Now You See TV for creating this format. It's a marvelous thing. And you can get a hold of me at fojcradio.com. In the morning, we are going to be up bright-eyed and bushy-tailed at 10 o'clock in the morning, have an FOJC radio church. And if you go to our website at fojcradio.com, you can go to our YouTube channel, and you can watch the original opening, the Gates of Enoch teaching that I did, and the other one on the Book of Enoch and Wandering Planets. And it's got a lot more information there along the same lines we're discussing this evening. Zen?
Well, I'd have to just say it's an honor and a privilege to be here with both of you. And I do consider Now You See TV, the listening audience, and this platform as one of my most favorite. And I appreciate, John, you know, putting it together in the way that you have, and all the listeners blessing it and congregating around it. Most certainly they are finding truth and finding guidance, direction, and answer for so much that they have been curious about. And so that's why, in my belief, they are a supporter of this network. And as far as my work, I do two radio shows, one every Saturday, 7 to 9 p.m. on Truth Frequency Radio called Secrets Revealed, every Wednesday evening on Revolution Radio, 8 to 10 p.m. Eastern at freedomslips.com. You can find my books at zengarcia.com. We run a truth network at fallenangels.tv, and you can contact me on Facebook. I'm the author of 10 books. I'm working on 3 others right now, a trilogy on the Great Contest. The book on the War in Heaven should be released maybe in about a month. I do appreciate all of you, and thank you for the time and the opportunity and for listening to us. Without you, you know, we'd just be talking to ourselves, and what good would that be?
Yeah, and we probably do a little bit of talking to ourselves anyway, so we enjoy the audience. But everything that they said, I mirror that 100%. You guys are great. We're thankful. We're thankful for Zen and David to come on here and talk about these things, because this isn't a popular topic. I know people are like, oh, you're just doing it for this or that. This is, and we could easily Joelstein it up if we wanted to, but that's not what we're here to do. We're here to talk about things, not because they're easy, but because they're hard. We talk about these things that are mysteries to us, and we as humanity want to know what the mysteries, where they lie. And we also want to listen to the Holy Spirit. We want him to guide us into all truth, and we want to discover the wisdom of the world. And that's, the Bible says, get wisdom. It tells you over and over again in the Book of Proverbs to get wisdom. So that's what we're here to do. We also want to point people to Yeshua, Jesus, Yeshua through Jesus in English. We want people to point him to that. And so we cover topics like this that are not popular to a lot of Christians, because they want to shut their ears to anything. And the problem is the world doesn't. And guess what? The world's going to go and they're going to look for this information. And if they don't find it with us, then they're finding it with some pretty jacked up people. I mean, look at the Ancient Aliens show. There's some real messed up theology going on there, and we have to cover this stuff. As the church, we have to be everything to every person. According to Paul, we become all things to all men, and this is part of that. I know there's a lot of ministries that bash what we do, and they say, you should be just covering the Torah, you should be just doing that. No, that's not true. That is not what we're called to do. We're called to be salt in the earth. We're called to reach the lost and cast our net wide and bring in the fish. That's what we're trying to do. And there's no doubt that this subject is very popular in these times. Why? Because the world is trying to deceive people. If you look at almost every movie that's out, it's all about superheroes, this, somebody coming to save the world, somebody coming to destroy the world, transhumanism, all these different things are coming upon this earth. People are going to be greatly deceived if the church doesn't step up and do their job and talk to people about this stuff. Wake up, church, wake up, because time is running short. And if you are not awake, if you're not awake, you may be deceived. There's going to be a lot of pastors out there that are going to be running to accept the mark of the beast, and they're going to lead a whole flock with them.
Amen.
No doubt about it. So there we go, people. Blessings to you guys. High five.
High five.
Until next time, this is Now You See TV, and we will talk to you guys again soon. Thank you.
Be blessed.